Good evening, everybody. I'm Stesha Brandon, the Literature and Humanities Program Manager at the Seattle Public Library. As we begin tonight, I would like to acknowledge that we are on Indigenous land. Here in Seattle, these are the traditional unceded territories of the Coast Salish people, specifically the Duwamish people. We honor their elders, past and present, and thank them for their stewardship of this land. Welcome to tonight's program with Quintard Taylor and Quin’Nita Cobbins-Modica. We're grateful to our author series sponsors, the Gary and Connie Kunis Foundation, and to the Seattle Times for their generous support of library programs. Thank you as well to the Seattle Public Library Foundation. Private gifts to the foundation from thousands of donors help the library provide free programs and services that touch the lives of everyone in our community. I want to give a big hello and welcome to all of our attendees here at Central Library and also watching the live stream. I have just a few announcements before we get started. Elliott Bay Books have copies of Dr. Taylor's book. If you're here with us in person tonight, they have copies at the table that's to your right. And if you're watching online, you'll be able to find books at their website, elliottbaybook.com. And I will be posting direct links to the book in the chat as the program progresses. Dr. Taylor is happy to sign your books after the event, and we're encouraging folks to be masked in the personalization line just for everybody's safety. For folks here in person, as I mentioned, if you need to exit the auditorium during the event, there's a door to your right. And as you notice, the building is officially closed, but the restrooms are open for the duration of the program. After tonight's conversation, there will be time for questions from the audience. Folks here in person, you can write your questions on the cards that you received as you came in. If you did not get a card because I was chatting away with one of our wonderful speakers, we have cards on the table there, and I can pass them out at toward the end of the event as well. I'll collect the cards at the end of the event, and the moderator will go ahead and ask those. And if you're watching online, you can ask your question at any time by writing it in the Q&A box at the bottom of your screen. And finally, we're interested in hearing from you. Toward the close of the event, we'll be posting a link to a survey in the chat, and we'll also be collecting the paper surveys from folks here in person. And I would just really appreciate it if you took a minute to fill it out after the program. I read all of the surveys, and it does shape the programming that we host here at the library. Tonight's program is presented in partnership with our friends over at Elliott Bay Book Company, Northwest African American Museum, and University of Washington Press. The University of Washington Press is a mission-driven, nonprofit book publisher based at the University of Washington. And I'm not sure if you know, but they are the oldest and largest publisher of scholarly and general interest books here in the Pacific Northwest. And now I am delighted to welcome Lanisha DeBartoleben, who will say a few words about the wonderful Northwest African American Museum and tell us a little bit more about what they've been up to. So welcome, Lanisha.
Thank you, Stesha, and the Seattle Public Library. Good evening. On behalf of all of the members of the Northwest African American Museum, we bring you greetings. We strive to advance justice and equity, cultivate educational empowerment, and center and celebrate Black history, art, and culture. And we're delighted to salute this evening the scholar of the evening, the brilliant and the gracious Dr. Quintard Taylor. We are so grateful to Dr. Taylor for just allowing this story to be told, for telling and retelling the story of a people, of a place, of a purpose, and of pride, Central District pride. Dr. Taylor has traced the roots of this Central District to their origin, and we thank him for this book and providing us reflection upon this place that we all affectionately call the CD. Thank you, Dr. Taylor, for giving voice to the experiences of a people. We thank you for enriching our understanding of local Black history. The sense of community identity runs deep in the Central District, and we thank you for honoring that identity. And we are grateful to you, Dr. Quin’Nita Cobbins-Modica, for centering the women. We hope that you all enjoy the book and tonight's discussion. Thank you, and back to Stesha.
Thanks so much, Lanisha. So I have the distinct honor of introducing our wonderful speakers. Quintard Taylor is the Scott and Dorothy Bullitt Professor of American History and Professor Emeritus at the University of Washington. He's the author of renowned works such as In Search of the Racial Frontier, African Americans in the American West, 1528 to 1990, and America I Am, Black Facts, The Timeline of African American History, 1601 to 2008, as well as co-editor of several volumes, including African American Women Confront the West, 1600 to 2000, and Seeking El Dorado, African Americans in California. He also co-authored Dr. Sam, Soldier, Educator, Advocate, Friend, an autobiography, and he is the founder of blackpast.org, a website with 7,500 entries on African American and global African history, which had over 6 million worldwide visitors in 2020. We'll be talking tonight with Quin’Nita Cobbins-Modica, who is an assistant professor of history at Seattle Pacific University, a historian of Black women's activism in the American West. Quin’Nita is the co-author of Seattle on the Spot, The Photographs of Al Smith, and the former executive director of blackpast.org, an invaluable online collection of articles, research, and profiles regarding African-American and global African histories. Please help me welcome Quintard Taylor and Quin’Nita Cobbins-Modica.
Wow, thank you, Stesha, for those wonderful introductions, and welcome, everyone. Quintard, I must say it is an honor to be with you here tonight in person to celebrate the second edition release of Foraging of a Black Community.
Thank you.
Nearly 30 years later. Wow, that is definitely an accomplishment. Mm-hmm. And as all of you all know, that foraging remains the definitive study of African Americans here in Seattle. And so I want to open up the conversation and just ask you, what motivated you to write this collective community biography of African Americans here in Seattle?
Okay.
Who are some of your early influences?
Okay, let me answer that, but let me try to urge again, everybody come closer if you can. I know that sounds like church, you know, but this is a small group and I want to see faces. I want to see everybody's faces. Thank you. Yeah, thank you for coming down a little bit closer. You can all hear me. Okay. Where do I start? I guess the best way to start is to talk about, and I hope I don't bore you with this story, to talk about how my search for African American history began when I was a kid, when I was growing up in a place called Brownsville, Tennessee. And most of you will have never heard of Brownsville, but it's the home of Tina Turner. I always reference that because you haven't heard of Brownsville, but people have heard of Tina Turner. I grew up in a segregated community. I grew up in a predominantly Black community. I lived in Haywood County, Tennessee, one of two predominantly Black counties in Tennessee. It was structured along the lines of deep segregation. As I said earlier in the presentation today, I never saw the inside of a public library when I was growing up. I didn't see the inside of a public library until I was in college. And quite frankly, except for some of the information that was passed on through some of the churches, there was no discussion of African American history. There's a story that I always like to share. It's a story from my father, and I'll just share it with you briefly because we're all friends here. I was probably 10, 12 years old, and I was digging holes in the backyard, so my father was planting trees. And he said to me, boy, he always called me boy, why is it then that when the lion and the man fight, the lion always loses? And I said, Pop, I don't know. And he said, because the lion has never learned to write. And I want you to think about that comment for me. He was profound. My father had a second grade education, but that was one of the most profound things he ever said to me. And it made me realize that he who controls history controls the story, controls the narrative, controls the impressions that people are going to get. And for the longest time, African-Americans never told their story. African-Americans never, I'll put it in his terms, the lion never learned to write. And so I didn't realize what that meant until I got into college. And in college, I decided, well, maybe it's time for me to be one of those lions. Maybe it's time for me to start writing African-American history. And in a way, that informs everything that comes after that. Now, there was a problem in college. I went to a predominantly Black school, HBCU. And I'm proud of that. But I'm going to confess to you that it wasn't until my senior year, actually the last semester that I was in college, that I had an African-American history course. I still remember the person who taught it, Dr. Julius Nemens, who went on to become president of what would become the University of District of Columbia. And he was great. He introduced me to all kinds of concepts that I'd never, I was in a Black school. I had been in a Black school for, you know, 3.5 years, and only then was I being exposed to African-American history. But it was, for me, it was a turning point. It meant that, you know, my dad's point about lions learning to write and understanding that there were some lions who actually written some history made me aware of what I wanted to do. And, you know, as fate would have it, 2 years later, only 2 years later, I was actually teaching an African-American history course at, of all places, Washington State University. And I can confess to you that I was about, you know, half a day ahead of the students in terms of learning. I was rapidly learning that history so that I could teach the students. But even there, there was a flaw. Even there, there was a flaw. And the flaw was that the kind of African-American history that was being taught at that time focused on the South, Washington State University in 1971. And there was this tall, lanky kid, a Black kid who was playing on the basketball team at WSU at that time. I'll give you his name. It's Billy Ray Flowers. Billy Ray went on to become a doctor and very successful. But at that point, Billy Ray raised his hand. And when Billy Ray raises his hand, you can't miss it. You know, it's big. And he said, and I love this, he said, why is it when you people, he referred to me as you people, why is it when you people, he was talking about historians here, why is it when you people talk about African-American history that you never discuss the Black West? And in all of my 22 years of arrogance, I said to him, because there is no Black Western history. That's exactly what I said to him. And he challenged me. I mean, people don't usually do that or didn't do it later on, but he challenged me and he said, yes, there is. And he started talking about his family that came to Portland in the 1850s. And I was so fascinated by that because I had never heard that before. I had never read, even Julius Nemens and Raleigh had never taught me that. Nobody in grad school had taught me that. And I'm saying, wow, this is amazing. I knew enough about Portland to know that it was founded in the 1850s, which meant that there were Black people in Portland almost from the very beginning. And I was so fascinated with that that I actually decided at the end of the course to get to apply for a small grant from Washington State University. I applied for the grant, got enough money so that we could rent a car, get a car from WSU. I could get a tape recorder and I could hire a research assistant. And guess what? The research assistant was Billy Ray Flowers. And we began, I'm sorry I'm taking so long on this, but I want you to know the journey to the book that we're talking about. And so Billy Ray Flowers and I went out and we started looking at that Black history. Now, when we went out and we started looking at that history, we didn't go to Seattle. We didn't go to Portland. We went to places like Moscow and Potlatch in Idaho. We went to places like Lewiston in Idaho and Clarkston in Washington. We went to other small towns, all up and down, all throughout the Palouse, looking for this elusive African-American history. And lo and behold, you know, there was one family that stands out. It was called the King family. The family had migrated out from North Carolina in 1889, just a year before Idaho became a state. They had settled an entire valley, probably about 3,000 acres of land, and it was still called, the signs were still there, it was called the King Valley. You know, people talk about the King Valley on TV. That's the real King Valley. And then these were Black farmers who lived no more than 40 miles from WSU. You know, and I'm thinking, wow, if Black history is near WSU, where else can it be? And I found out it was all over the Northwest. And eventually we did come to Seattle, we did come to Portland, but we found Black history right there in our backyard at Washington State University. And the consequence of this is that I got even more curious about this African-American. I'm getting to the end, okay, promise you. And we got even more curious about this. And I eventually wrote a dissertation. Well, let me back up. Before I even got to the dissertation, we were able to get a grant from what was then HEW, Health, Education, and Welfare, a grant of, I think, some $270,000, which was a lot of money for us then. And we were given the charge of going out and taking some of this history that I was actually gathering at the time and putting it in a series of documentaries. And those documentaries became South by Northwest. And if you look hard on the internet or you go to Black Pass, you can actually see them. They're terrible. I mean, we didn't know what we were doing. I was the assistant director. I remember the director once coming to me and saying, you know, we've lost our writer, our screenwriter. We need you to be a screenwriter. And I said, I'm not a screenwriter, I'm a historian. And he said, you're a screenwriter today. And at that point, I was writing the script for the scenes that we were shooting for people like Esther Roll. I don't know if you guys remember Esther Roll or Thalmas Rasawala or Bernie Casey, all the big stars from the 1970s. I know I'm dating myself, this is a younger crowd. But anyway, we had all these big stars because they were desperate for work and they liked what we were doing. They liked the idea of promoting African-American history. So it's from that series that we did that would eventually be shown to something like 20 million people. And sometimes on the late, 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 in the late, late hour, you can find it on TV today. But it was that series that led to my dissertation. And the dissertation was a history of Blacks in the Pacific Northwest. I went back to Minnesota. I did it at the University of Minnesota. And it was based upon that research that we had done as a result of Billy Ray Flowers' question. The reason I raise this is because if you guys are students, raise questions. Those questions can be life-defining. That Billy Ray Flowers question essentially kickstarted an entire career for me, and maybe in some ways kickstarted an entire field, the field of African-American history in the West. Anyway, to make a long story short, because I'm taking up too much time here, you know, we eventually wrote the dissertation and we tried to submit it to the University of Washington Press. The Washington Press representatives is here, oh boy. And they rejected the dissertation. They said, come back with a story on Seattle. We don't care about Montana and Idaho and Oregon. You know, come back with a story on Seattle and we'll entertain it. Took me about 10 years, but I finally came back with what became Forging, the Forging of a Black Community. That's how the book finally came to be. And it was a struggle. There's no question about it. It was a struggle. I was raising a family. We were teaching and a lot of things were going on, but I knew that this was an important book that had to be written because it harked back to Billy Ray Flowers' comment about how there's Black people in the West don't feel that there's any history for them. And yet the history is there. Somebody's got to be a lion to tell it. Somebody's got to come along and put all that information together to tell that story. Now, I haven't done the history of Portland. I'm not going to do that. But you know, we decided to do the Seattle book. And
what was different,
I'm amazed,
about Seattle? The reason why you chose Seattle?
Well, I chose Seattle because I was at WSU. Right. that's the reason. It was because it's the largest city, largest Black community in the Pacific Northwest. But here's the key, Quin’Nita. After choosing it, I then began to realize how different Seattle was. Because there was kind of a mantra in the 1970s and 1980s that if you write about New York and you write about the Black community in New York or the Black community in Chicago, that you've written about every ghetto in the country. We used to call them ghettos at that time. You know, we don't use that term anymore. But if you've written about New York and Chicago, there's no reason to write about anywhere else because you've written essentially the story. It's the same, as some reviewer said, It's the same tragic story, city after city. And it shortly came to me that that's not Seattle, that that's absolutely not Seattle. Seattle is not, you know, a city that's dominated by, you know, tenement houses with thousands of people crowded in. Seattle is, I mean, certainly there was segregation in Seattle. There's no question about that. We talked about that segregation. But in many respects, Seattle was so very different. It was different because it had an Asian population. And in point of fact, the Asians were treated worse than Black folks were for the longest time. And that actually allowed for some, you know, some space, some social space for African Americans. The other thing is that, and I'm not sure I know even to this day why this was, but Seattle in the 1880s and 1890s was actually more liberal than it would be in the 1930s, 1940s, 1950s. And so that kind of line, that kind of progression from, you know, very bad society to less, slightly less bad society to the present, it didn't work in Seattle. I've often said I should have called the foraging book, you know, Back to the Future, because what we're trying to do now, literally what we are trying to do now in Seattle, is to get us back to the way Seattle was in the 1890s, where it was a much more open society. There was no segregation. The Black businesses catered to everybody. There were hundreds of Black businesses. There was no Black business that depended upon Black clientele, Black patronage only, because there weren't that many Black people here. The largest Black business was next to Yesler's Pier, Yesler's Sawmill, and Black people lived everywhere, everywhere in the city of Seattle. All of that changed by the 1920s. And so Seattle is an example of, I don't know, what's the opposite of progress, retrogress? So, you know, Seattle is the example of a place that's gone backward. The other thing about Seattle, and how do I say this? But you've written about it brilliantly in your introduction. You should read her introduction. Don't read my book. Read her introduction to my book. You'll get more out of that than my book. But, you know, the other thing about Seattle is that it prides itself on being liberal. And when you talk about African-American history, that liberal veneer sort of pulls itself away, strings itself away. There was a strong Klan here in the 1920s, a Klan meeting in downtown Seattle, maybe even on this block. You know, it's hard to imagine the Klan in Seattle, but they were here. In the 1930s and 1940s, well, really right up until the 1960s, there were restricted covenants that kept Black folks in the Central District. I live in a condo today. To put it in perspective, to show you this ain't ancient history, I live in a condo today that refused to have Black people in it up through the 1970s, okay? That refused to allow Black people to live. This is despite, you know, the Civil Rights Act, the Open Housing Act. So we aren't as far from, you know, the past as we like to think that we are, where those shadows are still very, very much around. And as a matter of fact, I did a presentation the other day on housing, and there was a headline in the Seattle Times in 2020 on housing discrimination based on race. 2020, you all are old enough to remember 2020, okay? That's just a couple of years ago. And so the problem hasn't gone away. But anyway, to answer your question, I'm sorry, to answer your question, it was that idea that Seattle was different that drove me to it. But it was also that idea that Seattle prided itself on being far more liberal than it actually is.
Right.
And it's my book tended to sort of begin to strip away at that. Now, there are other authors who come along, and you're working on this theme as well. There were other authors who came along and continued to strip away at that liberal facade. But what Foraging did was to say, maybe Seattle is not as liberal as it likes to believe that it is. Maybe it's not. Maybe there's a phrase, and I only remember it because you quoted me on it. It's called the illusion of inclusion. Mm-hmm. The illusion of inclusion. In other words, the idea that Black people are really part of the society in Seattle, and yet maybe they aren't. Maybe we aren't as much as we like to believe we are. I have talked way too long, so I'm sorry.
And just on that idea alone, that because there's this idea that Seattle is liberal, that it's racially tolerant, somehow racism, mm-hmm. you know, existed here, you know, it made it in a certain degree harder to fight.
Absolutely. Right.
Freddie Mae Goucher, she mentioned that here in Seattle, you experience these little nasties, the silent dogs gnarling at you, which made it very difficult to fight because it's not as overt or in your face like it is in the Deep South, in the deep south parts of the country. And so it has been this uphill battle for African Americans to pursue racial justice, economic justice, as well as gender justice as well. And so, you know, I want to just backtrack a little bit because you mentioned how you got interested in doing African-American history. And it made me think about my own story and how I became interested in African-American history, because I am also from the Deep South, the rural South.
Even deeper than Brownsville.
Oh yeah, deeper, deeper.
Okay. Even deeper than Brownsville.
Deeper than Brownsville, Tennessee. And what's interesting about my story is that I grew up in a predominantly Black county. And because of that, you know, I was protected from the most egregious forms of racism. Right. It was a very, you know, insular community where everyone in positions of leadership and of influence was Black. They controlled everything. The sheriff is Black. The superintendent of education is Black. All of my teachers were Black. And so for me, that was the norm. It wasn't an aberration until I left the South and realized that that is not normal, right? And I've always had this interest in African-American history because many of those people in leadership positions were women, Black women. And so for me, I wanted to explore that in other areas, particularly outside the South, and moving here to Seattle and noticing how many Southern transplants were here. And that's how I began to ask questions about how do you all get out here? Because I heard that same great migration story that the majority of people who left Mississippi in particular went to Chicago. I have a lot of cousins in Chicago. Detroit, St. Louis, but I rarely ever heard about Black people coming out West. And I wanted to explore that story more, particularly with Black women, because I know they have contributed something because they were doing it in the South, they were doing it in the East. And so by coming here to Seattle, I was then able to ask some of the same kind of questions you were asking about the influences of African Americans, even though they were just a small population. What did they contribute? You know, were their experiences here different from other parts of the country and why? You know, what were their external, internal factors that led to that? And so for me, Black women, and particularly going to the HBCU at Fisk University, where Black history was taught, it was integrated in the curriculum, no matter what field of study. We learned about Black people, we learned about civil rights, social justice, and also that we had the special responsibility and calling to kind of do this work, because there are dominant narratives that are out there that demonizes African Americans. There are dominant narratives out there that say that African Americans really didn't contribute to anything. And so it propagates American mythology. And when we do that, their rhetoric can be very, very dangerous to say that African Americans never contributed to anything. So therefore it justifies mass incarceration. It justifies, you know, enslavement. It justifies Jim Crow, right? And so I think that's very important, the work that we do as historians, but particularly in this area, in the American West, where even still there's that sort of bias where people believe Black people have not done anything. I've gone to conferences with well-intentioned scholars. I don't know if you receive this kind of question, but they're always asking, Quin’Nita, how are you doing your work on Black women or Black people in Seattle? Do they even exist? I don't know if you received that.
Of course I have.
So, you know, in other parts of the country, there's still this idea that Black people really haven't contributed anything to this area. And I want, that kind of leads into my next question about what is it specifically do you think within the 20th century that Black people made the greatest contribution?
Okay, you mean
Seattle.
Black people in Seattle?
Yeah, in Seattle.
Black people in Seattle. Well, first of all, I want to reinforce what you said. I think there are a couple of things. I think you came along much later. You're much younger than I am. And so by the time you came along, there had been the Civil Rights Revolution and all these Black office holders. I go to Brownsville now and there are Black office holders. There were none when I was growing up in the 1960s. But I also, your comment about how people perceive of the West, and particularly the Black West, in such strange ways. I can remember two comments. I'll give you two comments. The first comment was a good friend of mine. He's still a good friend of mine, but I remember him saying to me when I told him I was gonna do Black and Western history, he said, and he's a historian, he said with a straight face, nobody cares about 9 Negroes in the West. And this guy was from the West, okay? And I said, what's going on here? The other thing, I remember coming back to the University of Washington and I was doing research, and this was in the 1980s. And I went to the special collections area and I said, I want everything you have on African-American history in Seattle. Okay. The woman went back into the files, or actually into the shelves, and she came back with this Black covered dissertation. And she said, we have this dissertation written by this guy named Quintard Taylor on African-American history in the West. That's all we have on Seattle. And I say, wow. And that was one of the things that motivated me, because as Billy Ray Flowers said, well, he didn't say this, but I think it was very, I think it was implicit in almost everything he said to me. There's this belief among Black people, particularly in the West, and to some extent, white people as well, that as you said, Black people not only have not contributed, but Black people don't even exist. Mm-hmm. That Black people don't even exist. And so writing Foraging was an attempt to a broadside against that notion. I saw in the 1970s when I was teaching, I saw Black kids from Portland and Seattle who really always felt self-conscious because they weren't from Mississippi, they weren't from Washington, D.C., they weren't from New York, where, quote, real Black culture exists. And one of the things that I tried to say, as a matter of fact, I said it in each one of my classes until the day I stopped teaching. I said, there are a lot of Black experiences. And if you grew up Black in Bellevue, that's your experience, okay? Think about that. If you grew up Black in Bellevue, that's your experience. And it's validate Black experiences that of anybody growing up in Mississippi or Tennessee or New York. And I wanted to put something to back that up. And that's why we did African American history in the West. That's why we continue to do Black history in the West, because we want people out here to never believe that they're second class citizens to other Black people or to anybody else. That, if you grew up in Seattle, you have a strong and vibrant Black history. It may not be like New York. It may not be like Alabama. It may not be like some other place, but it is as valid as anywhere else in the country, anywhere else in the world. And so the idea was to say, there are a variety of African-American experiences. There is no one Black experience. In the 19, I got so tired of hearing there's the Black experience. There is no Black experience. There are Black experiences. And each one is different. Each one is shaped by our own views, our values, our upbringing, and everything else. Everybody in this room, including the white folks, have a Black experience, and that experience is different for everyone in this room. So I've railed against the notion. I'm sorry, Quin’Nita, but I've railed against that notion that there is one Black experience, and it's whatever happened in Mississippi or whatever happened in Chicago or whatever happened in New York. No, it's what happened in Seattle.
And that's why I assign your work in my classroom, because students have one way of viewing African-American history, right. African-American culture. It follows this classical traditional model. But when I introduce them to chapters from both mm-hmm. your books, In mm-hmm. Search of Racial Frontier or Foraging, it complicates that narrative. Right. right? It gives them a different perspective about the African-American experiences. And it also makes an argument that the African-American community is not monolithic.
Right.
And it depends on the geography. You know, it depends on a lot of these social factors, economic factors, political factors, and where they are, where African-Americans mm-hmm. are located. But going back to the earlier question about what specifically during the 20th century, do you see the African-Americans making the greatest impact here?
Yeah, I'm sorry, I didn't answer.
No, no, it's okay.
For Seattle, I'm speaking for Seattle because we're talking about forging now. For Seattle, I think it was clearly the 1960s. And I say it was not the 1960s because, and it sort of harks back to your point about Black leadership. There were African-Americans in Seattle through the 1940s, 1950s, into the 1960s. But what I think the civil rights movement did in Seattle was to bring to the fore a Black leadership that for the first time extended beyond the Black community. One of the images, and unfortunately we don't have a way to show images here tonight because of, you know, this is being live streamed. But one of the images that so struck me when I first began to do the research on Seattle was the idea of a group of Black leaders leading 5,000 white folks on a march for racial justice. Where else in the world do you see this kind of thing, you know, or an open housing demonstration? And most of the people who, and for those of you who don't know what open housing is, it's the concept of being able to live in any community you want anywhere in the city of Seattle. I mean, nobody even thinks about that now. We all have open housing almost as a given. But there was a time in the 1960s when Black people couldn't live beyond the Central District, literally could not live beyond the Central District. And so open housing was about Black leadership, Black leaders coming together, the head of the NAACP, the head of the Urban League, the head of various other organizations coming together and saying, we demand justice. We want to have an open society. And getting the support of tens of thousands of white people to back them. Now, let me fast forward to the end of the decade, the 1960s. Again, this tremendous activism. In the late 1960s, we see the rise of Black power. And with the rise of Black power, you see a new leadership class coming together. And that new leadership class is sort of symbolized by the rise of the Black Panther Party. As you pointed out, the Black Panthers had their first chapter outside of California right here. And the Black Panther Party, how do I say this? They were probably as influential, if not more influential, among young radical whites than in some ways they were among Black folks. And so here are two very different examples, but both examples of Black people being able to mobilize larger communities for the first time. That had not happened in Seattle before. Black people had been marginal. Black people had formed coalitions, sometimes with other communities of color. But to actually lead large coalitions. I mean, I think about, and I'll put it in perspective. Remember the George Floyd demonstrations? Mm-hmm. You know, you saw them here in Seattle. They were all around the world. Those demonstrations, you know, mobilized large numbers of non-Black people, but they were led by Black folks. They were almost automatically led by Black folks. Well, that's what you had in Seattle in the 1960s. And so that's the kind of change. I don't know if, Lanisha, I don't know if that happened in Detroit. I don't know, it may have happened in other places, but I was struck by the extent to which it happened here in Seattle. And so Black leadership came into its own in the 1960s. And that's one of the reasons why you can write on all of those spectacular Black women in the 1970s and 1980s who literally controlled, well, maybe control is a bad word, but literally had this outsized influence over the entire city. And I don't think that could have happened had the 1960s not sort of opened the door for that kind of thing. And so, yeah, I think other people can disagree, and we're gonna open this up to questions in a minute, but I think that the 1960s were probably the pivotal point mm-hmm. for African Americans in Seattle, because for the first time, some white folks got it in terms of that whole business of racial justice. Not enough, but some got it because they came and they demonstrated and they showed their solidarity with Black people who were struggling for racial justice. And that just hadn't happened before. You know, I can't speak for other places, but that hadn't happened in Seattle until the 1960s. So yeah, I think the 1960s were a turning point. I mean, what we have today, I don't think you could have had the George Floyd phenomenon. Now, there are two things you can say about it. First of all, we didn't solve all the problems because we have the George Floyd phenomenon, you know, so racism is hardly dead. But on the other hand, I don't think you could have had the George Floyd phenomenon in Seattle had you not had, you know, when I say the phenomenon, I mean the massive demonstrations that took place here, had you not had that kind of emergence of Black leadership that attracted a following far beyond Black racial lines.
And you know, I was thinking also, because I agree with you, the 1960s was a consequential period within Seattle's history. And also, like during my research, this is where I see Black women taking on more leadership roles. Mm-hmm. They weren't just organizing, mm-hmm. but they were helping to lead right. those civil rights campaigns and efforts for mm-hmm. not just racial justice, but mm-hmm. also for them being oppressed as women. Mm-hmm. And at that level of grassroots leadership, mm-hmm. they're able to develop more power in this period where it catapults them into careers of public service, of mm-hmm. Political positions in government. We see Peggy Jo Maxey
right.
becoming the first Black woman to be elected to the Washington State Legislature. Mm-hmm. We also see Rosalind Woodhouse. She becomes mm-hmm. the first Black woman to serve mm-hmm. in a cabinet position under, is it Governor Dixie Lee Ray, if I'm not?
Could be, I'm not mistaken.
And Dorothy Hollingsworth, she mm-hmm. becomes the first African-American woman to serve on the school board mm-hmm. In this moment, in this period. Right. And they're getting a lot of their experience through mm-hmm. these different organizations within the 1960s, either working through the Civil Rights Movement, the Anti-Poverty Movement, as well as the Black Power Movement
yeah.
as well. These movements weren't mutually exclusive, but mm-hmm. women worked within and outside of them. And so yeah. I think it's fascinating yeah. Of how things radically changed for African-Americans in the 1960s.
Help me out here, because yeah. there was a Black woman who headed the NAACP here. That's right.
E. June Smith, yes.
See, this is almost unheard of. I think there probably were three Black women in all of America who headed NAACP chapters. And she headed this chapter at the time when all this civil rights activity is going on. She's vital. She's a central figure in all of this, which is amazing. It's amazing, not just on the Seattle level, it's amazing on the national level. Mm-hmm. Because you don't have very many examples like this. And so, yeah, I think the 1960s were pivotal. And I think in some ways, she becomes the model for all these women that mm-hmm. you talk about who emerge in the 1970s and 1980s.
Right. She was the only one, I believe, that had a formal leadership position where women were doing the roles and responsibilities of leadership, mm-hmm. but they didn't necessarily mm-hmm. have that formal
right.
position. Right. Right. All right, I think we're running out of time.
Are we? Did we get
we
the
are?
Signal? Or did we get the hook? We get pulled off the stage?
Yeah, I do have one more question before we go into the question and answer session, because I think it's really important, because we're here to celebrate, again, like I said, the second edition of this book, which is a monumental accomplishment. And you have left a profound legacy on the historical profession.
Yeah,
yes,
you
have, and have spent your entire career dedicated to the study and advancement of African-American history, of mentoring scholars and up-and-coming scholars like myself, and deepening our understanding of the long Black freedom struggle and the ways that Black folks have always been an essential part of the political, cultural, social, and economic fabric of the American West, as well as the nation at large. And so even in the 10 years I have known you, I've had the pleasure to work alongside you and witness you build the largest and most reputable digital platform on African-American global African history through blackpast.org.
So
this makes the history of people of African descent accessible to millions of people across the world, educating and inspiring a global public, but it also invites contributors from well over 200 countries to contribute to such a project, which makes it an international endeavor in scope. And so because of your storied 40 year career span, I wanted to know, you know, what message would you leave for people who might want to become a historian or those who are interested in researching and writing Black history?
Let me leave this message before I talk about those who want to write Black history. The message for doing all of this stuff means that I have tension with my fiance who's sitting there because she never sees me. You know, that's the downside of this. That's the, and so I guess I would warn anybody who wants to become a historian that be aware of the fact that you're going to have issues with your fiance or spouse because you're going to be so focused on your work. You have to be. You have to be focused on your work in order to be able to do that work. And that means you have to have a supportive spouse, an understanding spouse who says, I get it, and I can allow you to do that. You know, people have said that I have one mistress, and that's Black Pass. Mm-hmm. And that may be a true assessment because as Felicia's my fiance guy, she's very shy over there. But as Felicia knows, I get up at 3 a.m. and I'm working on history. But I do it because I just have a passion. I'm crazy. Okay, I'm crazy for history. I just believe this kind of stuff has to be done. I'm not saying that everybody has to do it this way. Mm-hmm. I am not saying that everybody has to do it this way. But I am saying that I just believe that the Black people have a very important story to tell. And I'm going to do everything I can to help tell that story. And I'm going to do that to my last dying. Okay, Felicia, you don't want to hear this. I'm going to do this to my last dying breath. Okay, that's my calling. That's my passion. And, you know, that may make me crazy, weird, whatever. So I don't say to people, you should become a historian as I am a historian. You should become a historian because you want to do something good. You want to tell that story. But, you know, try to keep everything in check because you want to keep your family intact too. Okay. Should we open it up to questions?
Is that a message for me too?
Yes. I wish Aaron were here to hear this, that he needs to hear it as well. That's her husband. Yeah, that sometimes when you get involved with a historian who's very passionate, and she's more passionate than I am. When you get involved with a historian who's very passionate, it means the spouse has to make some sacrifices. I'm sorry, that's the way it is, but that's what happens. You know, that's what happens. And not everybody is prepared to make those sacrifices. You know. Should we take questions from the audience? Or have we run out of time?
So much. I think we have run out of time.
We have run out of time?
Yes, we have.
Oh.
Well, we could listen to you both all night, but they might want to send us home at some point. But I'll start with a question from the online audience. Mm-hmm. One of the folks is wondering, is your dissertation available to be read?
I guess so. It's probably still in the the reserve room at the University of Washington Library. Yeah, you can go and ask for that dissertation that Taylor wrote back in the day. Yeah.
We'll make University of Washington Press need to go to print on that. Right?
Make them print the dissertation. Make them publish the dissertation after all of this. Yeah.
Excellent. Are there folks who need question cards in our in-person audience? Anybody need a card? Okay, I'll be right there.
I'll repeat it. I'll try. Okay. There are a lot of things that change. First of all,
Dr. Taylor, could you repeat the question for our online audience?
Sorry. The question is, Seattle was, I contend that Seattle was liberal before the 1920s. And the question is, what changed? What happened to Seattle? And I'm going to speculate here, but I would say that there are a couple of things, some that are internal to Seattle and then some that are national. The national is that you see the rise of the Ku Klux Klan. There's no question about that. The Klan was everywhere. The Klan dominated Oregon, of all places. They elected the governor in Oregon, and they were powerful in Indiana. So the Klan was no longer just a Southern phenomenon. Some people estimate that something like, you know, one out of every four Washingtonians who were white belonged to or was affiliated with the Klan. We have never seen anything like that before in Washington and Washington's history. I think that's part of it. I think the other part of it is a little bit more mundane. Washington and particularly Seattle grow very, very rapidly. And when you have a frontier society, people don't have time for the hangups about race and class and whatever. I mean, everybody has to pull together to survive. And as Seattle grew and as it became more successful and more prosperous, especially after the Alaska Gold Rush, you had literally thousands of people coming in from other areas of the country, and they wanted to create, not surprisingly, they wanted to create the same kind of structures that existed elsewhere. And one of those structures, one of the quintessentially American structures, is racial discrimination. And so they began to talk about, even if they weren't members of the Klan, they began to talk about the fact that, you know, we need to segregate Black people. Black people need to have their own sphere. Black people need to not integrate as they had been with others up until that point. So I think I think it's the internal in the sense that Seattle grows rapidly. There are Easterners who come in and they change the city. I don't want to blame it completely on it. There were races here even in the 1850s, 1860s. So I don't want to suggest that Seattle was a racial paradise at any time. But certainly it was more liberal in the 1890s than it would be in the 1920s. And maybe one of the reasons for that is this influx of people. Seattle, to put it in perspective, Seattle in 1880, if I remember my figures correctly, and Quin’Nita, check me if I'm wrong, Seattle in 1880 had about 5,000 people. It's not a big place. It's a very, very small place. By 1900, Seattle has over 100,000 people. That's a different place. That's a radically different, that's a radically radical growth. And that growth brings in people who have, you know, a lot of different ideas about what is right or what should be right and what should be the structure. So there's that, Seattle changing from the inside, but there's also the rise, the national rise of racism throughout the country, particularly with the emergence of the Ku Klux Klan for the first time as a national organization. I mean, imagine, it's hard for us to imagine today, but 20,000 Klansmen marched down Pennsylvania Avenue in 1923. Mm-hmm. 20,000 Klansmen. If you thought January 6th was bad, okay, think of the idea of 20,000 Klansmen marching down the same route that every president marches when he, unfortunately there's no she yet, but when he is inaugurated president of the US. That's how powerful the Klan was. And the Klan bragged on being the unofficial, I don't know if I'd say the unofficial or not, but certainly the invisible government of the United States. They were the invisible government of the United, well, they weren't so invisible that they could march down Pennsylvania Avenue. Mm-hmm. And so if the Klan could do that in broad daylight in Washington, D.C., imagine what they could do in a city like Seattle. So that those are the two sharp, I don't know if that's a complete answer, but those are certainly two answers I can think of off the top of my head at what changed. But there are probably other things that changed too. Now, one thing that complicates, as Quin’Nita said, I'd love to complicate this history. One of the things that complicates this is that I believe that in some ways, Seattle was good for Black people because most whites were focused on a different racial group, the Asians. Mm-hmm. You know, at a moment when Black people were saying Seattle is a great place to live, there were anti-Asian riots, not only in Seattle, but also in, imagine, Issaquah, Tacoma, yeah. You know, and Everett, and on and on and on. And so it may be I don't want to go too far with this, but it may be that it's the presence of Asians that sort of drew attention away from African Americans at that moment, in that moment in time. So again, it's a complicated story. It's a story that you know, has a whole host of strands that, you know, get brought together, in some ways get tangled together, for us to try to figure out or try to fathom the situation.
I think you also mentioned too, in your book, you give a quote by a newspaper here in Seattle, mm-hmm. that, you know, Black people would do well if their numbers don't grow or something.
Yeah,
you know,
right.
To that effect.
The Seattle PI, yeah. The Seattle, yeah. PI said specifically,
yeah, don't,
you know,
overstep
Black people
that color line
fine,
that
but
balance.
Don't cut, no, yep. More don't cut. But what's interesting is this character named Horace Caden. I don't know, mm-hmm. how much time we have, but there's this character named Horace Caden. And Horace Caden is so representative of what went wrong, of what went downhill in terms of race for Black people in Seattle. Quick background, Horace Caden was born of a slave mother, a white plantation owner farm, Black white plantation owner in Mississippi. And he migrated out west. He married well. He married the daughter of the first Black US senator from Mississippi. There's an interesting story about how she was the youngest daughter and she sort of booted out her older sister who had eyes for this guy, but that's a soap opera. That, you know, we won't get into that. But at any rate, Horace Caden marries the youngest daughter and he comes out west and he brings her out west and he eventually gets to Seattle. Long story short, he works for the Seattle PI. Eventually he gets money from the PI owner to start his own newspaper. His own newspaper is the Seattle Republican. And the Seattle Republican eventually becomes the number two paper in the city of Seattle. Notice I didn't say the number two Black paper, the number two paper in the city of Seattle in terms of circulation. And it has this weird makeup on the outside, on the two, it's a four sheet paper. On the two outside pages, there's political news about the Republican Party. And in Seattle at that time, you know, most people were Republican. On the inside, there's Black news. And this worked very well for Horace Caden. He became the wealthiest Black person. He and his family became the wealthiest Black family. They lived on Capitol Hill. They entertained the governor. They did all kinds of stuff. They were, you know, they were well-to-do. That's almost an understatement. And then Horace Caden, remembering his Mississippi roots, there was a lynching, and he decided to put the lynching on the front page. And that drove away almost all of the, you know, the white readership. And as a result, Caden got pushed out of his, another couple of factors. There was restrictive covenants that were pushing him out of his house, but there was also the lynching and the aftermath of the lynching. And as a result, Caden struggled after that. And it's very interesting because in 1906, Caden is saying, Black folks come, this is wonderful, this is the paradise. All you have to do is work hard and everything will be fine. By 1913, Horace Caden is one of the, I can't remember the exact number, but one of the dozen or so people who starts the NAACP in Seattle. Let me tell you something. You don't start an NAACP if everything is fine racially. You know, nobody starts an NAACP chapter if things are cool, you know.
His founding president was Letitia Graves, a Black woman.
And what, excuse me?
Letitia Graves was the founding
president.
That's
right. She,
yes,
was the founder. She was a Black woman beautician, mm-hmm. was the founder of the NAACP. And so there are all these people who are coming together in Seattle and saying, by 1913, maybe Seattle's not perfect. Mm-hmm. Maybe there are some problems. Maybe we need to do something about it. And so it's an amazing transition. It's an amazing turnaround that happened, you know, fairly quickly by, you know, historical standards. But it's a turnaround nonetheless. And I think Black people had to recognize that they were now living in a different environment, an environment that unfortunately was very much like, you know, the rest of the country. Seattle was becoming like the rest of the country. It was no longer exceptional. That's mm-hmm. the point.
We have several questions from our online audience as well. From our friend Noni at African American Writers Alliance. Dr. Taylor, do you ever have the opportunity to share your work with youth, elementary and up? I'm curious how they receive this information from you, which is not reflected in their academic K-12 books. How do they react and respond?
Oh boy. I'll make that a short answer. No, I don't give presentations to elementary schools or youth. The best thing that I can do in terms of the youth is to have them come to Black Pass. That's why we set up Black Pass, so that this information would be available to people of all ages. And that, the one thing that I do know is that there are young people who are using Black Pass. Mm-hmm. You know, so that's the way I respond to that. I don't mind. I'd love for somebody to step forward and say, I want to do a children's edition of Forging.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
That's a hint, folks. Yeah. That's a hint. You know, I'd love that. But I can't do it because I don't know how to write children's literature. But I certainly would work with somebody else who wanted to do it. And I you know, I won't be modest about this. I think Forging would be a great book for kids.
I think so, you know? Yeah. So. That's great. Quin’Nita, do you have an in-person question?
From our audience here, for you, Dr. Taylor, Seahawks receiver Tyler Lockett just filmed a video for the NFL on the burning of Black Wall Street in Tulsa, Oklahoma. Mm-hmm. What are your thoughts on this injustice, and did it impact Seattle in any way?
Wow. Let me answer the second part of that first. I don't know if it did. I don't recall any Black people coming from Tulsa to Seattle right after that incident. But here's what I will say about this, and this sort of goes slightly against the grain. We focus a lot of time, and I think correctly, on what happened to Tulsa, the burning of Black Wall Street, okay? First of all, let's understand how Black Wall Street was created. It was created by the ingenuity of a whole host of Black entrepreneurs. They're the ones who built it up. And then it was destroyed by white folks. It was destroyed by a mob. And when I say destroyed, I mean every building, every commercial building, many of the houses were destroyed. The story that's not told, is that Black people built it back. Mm-hmm. That within 10 years, Black Wall Street was actually bigger and better than it had been before the burning. Now, I'm not erasing white responsibility for the burning. They shouldn't have destroyed the community as they did. And there are still efforts to seek reparations for it, and rightly so. But I think, you know, when people hear the story, they think, oh, Black Wall Street was destroyed, and that's the end of the story. It is not the end of the story, because Black people built it back up. The tragic irony is that Black Wall Street was ultimately destroyed, not by the riot in 1921, by urban renewal in the 1960s. Mm-hmm. Guess what? Somebody ran a freeway right through the middle of Black Wall Street, and that pretty well destroyed it. That did more damage in the long term than the rioting had done. I don't want to perpetuate this idea that Black Wall Street was destroyed and that was the end of it. No, Black people were smarter than that. Black people were more ingenious than that. Black people built it back. And then it's the federal government. Don't get me started on the Fed, but the federal government and its whole urban renewal programs, you know, all of that eventually would bring down Black Wall Street. But I also want you to know that there are Black Wall Streets all over the country. We sometimes focus on what happened in Tulsa and we say, that's the only one. No, you look at Durham, you look at the South Side of Chicago, you look at Detroit. Let me say this about Detroit. Okay, let me say this, because we have this image of Detroit today as this kind of urban wasteland, and maybe it's based upon the reality. But the history of Detroit, and I know we're not doing the history of Detroit, the nation, but the history of Detroit is that it was the Silicon Valley of America in the 1920s, the 1930s, 1940s. It was the place where people would go if they wanted to be prosperous. It had, mark my words, it had the largest Black middle class in the country right up through the 1960s, the largest Black middle class in the country. And it all went away, not because, and another myth, not because of the Detroit riot in 1967. It went away because automobile manufacturing peaked in Detroit in 1948, and it steadily declined from that point on. Detroit lost this major industry, and there was nothing that would replace it. Steel went in Pittsburgh got something else back. I don't know what happened in Chicago, but Chicago managed to reinvent itself. Detroit, for whatever reason, didn't do it. But let's understand that Detroit in its glory, Detroit in its heyday, was a remarkable place. And it was really the first place where a substantial Black middle class ever emerged, a Northern Black middle class ever emerged in America. And so we have this image of Detroit today, but let's understand what Detroit once was and what it could be again. You know, I hope that Detroit can do what, you know, what Black Wall Street did, to build itself back, to rebuild, to reestablish itself, as other communities have done. The biggest threat to the Black Wall Streets in America, can I editorialize? The biggest threat to Black Wall Streets today, how do I say this? The biggest threat to Black Wall Streets today is gentrification and its dispersal of the Black communities. The question that I have asked so many times, and it's not completely answered yet, can there be a Black community without a spatial concentration? We think of a Black community as where all the Black people live. Well, we're getting to the point now, and Seattle is a perfect example of this. In 2003, Seattle became only the third city in the country where there were more Black people who lived in its suburbs than lived in the central city. Think about that for a minute. Now, there are a lot of cities like that now, but Seattle became only the third after Los Angeles and Washington, D.C., where there were more Black people who lived in the suburbs than lived in the central city. The question, and this is a powerful question for Black folks, can there be a Black community without a spatial concentration? I believe there can, but I don't believe this is the night to talk about it because it's going to be a long discussion. But I think we have to reimagine what Black community means. We have to reimagine how we think of that community. And it may not necessarily be all the Black people living together in one area, because as you know, the Central District is no longer Black. That's one thing I couldn't have anticipated in my book. Can I tell that story?
Yeah.
Okay. I'm gonna stop after this. I have to tell this story. Her name was Constance Thomas, Mrs. Constance Thomas, a lovely woman. She then, when I was talking to her, she's my age now. She was 73. And she had given me a tour of Black Seattle, the Central District, because she had lived here all of her life. She was born in Seattle. She was the daughter of a Jamaican immigrant, a Garvey follower. And she talked about the Central District. And as I was taking her home, you know, and she was getting out of the car, she said, mark my word. This was what, 1971, 72, okay, maybe 73 at the latest. I can't remember exactly what day. But she said, mark my word. White folks are going to recognize that the Central District is a wonderful place to live. It's close in to downtown, and they're going to move back in. I didn't say anything, but I said to myself as I got in my car, that woman is smoking something. That at that particular moment, there had not been a successful gentrification anywhere in the country. There had not been a Black ghetto that had turned white. But look at what's going on today. She was right. I was the one who must have been smoking something. You know, I was wrong. And she anticipated, I don't know how she did it, but she anticipated what would happen to the Central District. She said, never forget this quote, mark my words, white folks will recognize that the Central District is a wonderful place to live, it's close to downtown, and they'll start moving back in here. So who knows? I mean, that I love telling that story because it sort of anticipates the changes. And that's the other thing about Seattle and the Black community. The one thing that's constant is change. The one thing that's constant is change. No matter what happens now, it's going to be different. And if we're not ready for that, you know, we're going to have a really, really hard time. Really, really hard time. And of course, change is what keeps historians like Quin’Nita and I in business. We traffic in change. We understand change.
Change
of time. Now, speaking of time, I'll stop.
All right. Our last question from the audience is, what do you hope this work brings to young Black folks whose family have roots in the city but are now in Renton, Kent, and Tacoma? You touched on a little bit.
Yeah. I hope these people will, I hope these young Black people will ask the question, can there be, can we maintain a sense of community when we're spread out, when there's, you know, spatial patterns where Black people are everywhere? I think they can, because I think Jewish people are doing it. I think other ethnic groups are doing it. Look at Ballard. Swedes live all over Seattle, but they come back to Ballard, you know, when the king visits, you know, they come back to Ballard to share in their roots, okay? So I think it's possible, but I think we have to think of community in a different way. We have to think of community not necessarily as a single place where everybody resides. We have to think of community as the way we share our history across distances. And one of the things that makes this far easier, folks, this is where technology comes into play. One of the things that makes this far easier now is the internet, because we have new communities. We have new communities as a result of the internet. I'll give you one more Black Pass story. You know, I talk about the fact that Black Pass is on the internet and people come to it. What's remarkable to me is that there are 350,000 people who are friends of Black Pass on Facebook. That's a community. Those are people who love African American history, and they are willing to share that history through Facebook. Whatever you think about Facebook, you know, Facebook is creating new forms of community, new types of community that people can respond to. I don't know. I mean, am I answering the question? I don't know if that's, but the answer is that you've got to learn to connect to your roots and learn to connect to that history. And organizations like Black Pass make it a lot easier than in the old days when you had to live in proximity to a church or a school that taught that history.
And there are spirited conversations and discussion that goes on the posts.
On the Facebook. Yeah, not everybody agrees with everything we post.
And Twitter, yeah.
Thank you both.
Thank you all.
Such a wonderful conversation, and just the beginning, because this is the second edition. We'll look for the children's edition.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah. Yes. Somebody do a children's edition. I would help them. Yeah. Love to see that.
Excellent. Well, for folks here in the audience, our friends over at Elliott Bay Book Company have copies of Dr. Taylor's book at the table to your right, and you can stay and get your book signed at that white table right over there. And then if you're heading out, you'll just need to exit through the 4th Avenue lobby, which is behind me. You can drop surveys in the basket on that table as you head out. And then for folks watching from home, you can find the link for the survey in the chat and copies of Dr. Taylor's book at ElliottBayBooks.com. And of course, you can find his books at the library as well, spl.org. We're so grateful to everybody who made tonight's program possible. Thank you to our program partners, Northwest African American Museum, University of Washington Press, and of course, Elliott Bay Book Company. And thanks to our sponsors, the Gary and Connie Kunis Foundation, the Seattle Public Library, and the Seattle Public Library Foundation, and the Seattle Times. Thanks so much for joining us, everybody, and we will see you next time. Good night.